that you will turn once again to Revelation, the 21st chapter. And we want to begin by looking at that 15th verse, and then we'll be moving to Revelation, the 22nd verse. First Revelation 21:15. The angel who talked to us held in his hand a gold measuring stick to measure the city, its gates and its walls. And when he measured it, he found that it was a square as wide as it was long. In fact, it was the form of a cube, for its length and width and height were each 1,400 miles. Then he measured the walls and found them to be 216 feet thick. The angel used a human measuring standard. And then moving to verse 22, no temple could be seen in the city, but the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are his temple. And the city has no need of sun or moon, for the glory of God illuminates the city, and the Lamb is its light. The nations of the earth will walk in its light, and the rulers of the world will come and bring their glory to it. The gates never close at the end of the day, because there is no night. And all the nations will bring their glory and honor into the city. Nothing evil will be allowed to enter, no one who practices shameful idolatry or dishonesty, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And the people of God said, amen. We ask for your prayers as we use as our sermon topic, blessings beyond measure. Blessings beyond measure. As we come to this end of the 21st chapter of Revelation, it's probably the most known chapter of all the books in Revelation. We began in the month of August by sharing that the first thing that happened in Revelation is that John had to look. And when John looked, he saw a new heaven and a new earth. But not only a new heaven and a new earth, John also saw a new Jerusalem. And this emphasis is on new. John is trying to let us all know that life is about changes. You cannot successfully navigate through life if you cannot adapt to the changes life brings. We come into the world with a change. You come from a womb into a physical space, a physical place. You come into the world, you have to change. When you enter school, you have to change. Middle school, high school, you have to change. If you go to college, you have to make the changes. If you go into the workforce, you have to make the changes. Going to military service, you have to make the changes. If you get married, you have to make the changes. If you have children, you have to make the changes. Very few persons have one job their entire life. And in many instances, each job you have or each different position you have in a job, you have to make changes. As you become grandparents, you have to make changes. Sometimes death comes, you have to make changes. Divorce comes, have to make changes. The song says, sometimes I'm riding high in April, shot down in May. You got to make changes. As you become a senior citizen, retirement, have to make changes. Changes in your physical body, have to make changes. Then the last and the greatest change is death, when you prayerfully move from earth to glory. So life is about change. And each one of the things that allows us to go through life and things change, it's new. And John is speaking to us because we have been in the last 17 months in the midst of a major change. And once this pandemic is over, we will have a greater change. We'll have to reimagine some things. We'll have to adapt to new normals. There will be changes that all of us will have to adapt to. And John wants to let us know, as he's sharing in the 21st chapter of Revelation, that with all these changes, God's going to be with you. That he created a new heaven and a new earth and a new Jerusalem. And the newness of what God creates is perfect. So whatever you stand in need of as you go through the changes you'll be going through, look to the one that can make your change into your blessing. For what is unexpected to us is not unexpected to God. He already knows what your future is, and if you guide and be guided by him and directed by him, he will help you navigate where it is you're ultimately supposed to go. So John said, first, look, there's newness. And then John says, listen, for there's a shout taking place in heaven. And John says, the reason why they're shouting, because God said, it's finished. And in other words, that which started in the Garden of Eden, that which God wanted to perfect between his relationship with human beings, that Satan tried to destroy that special relationship, that perfect relationship that God had with his human creation. And God says now, that which had been started in the garden and that which Satan had broken has now been perfected. It's finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Somebody said, ain't nobody that can work like him. And he's saying, now you have been reconciled back to me. And I want you to know, in this reconciliation, your needs are going to be met. There's no more crying, no more pain, no more death, no more sorrow. Whatever you stand in need of, God wants you to know it's already done. And then all of a sudden, we hear God speak. And when God speaks, everybody ought to listen. And when God was speaking, he was letting men and women know that things are going to work out for good. And the angel that had taken John up to heaven, and the angel that had shown John the Babylonian evil of that empire, was now showing John how beautiful things are going to be. She now takes John up into heaven. And in heaven, John begins to see the city and the walls of the city. And he begins to see the gates in the city. And the beauty of all of this is beyond imagination. And as John sees it, he says, there are three gates to the east and three gates to the north and three gates to the south and three gates to the west. And he talks about the precious stones and all the things that are made up. And then those gates are made with pearls. And John is just trying to share with us. And then all of a sudden, he sees the foundation of the city. And in the foundation, he sees the names of the 12 tribes of Israel, but he also sees the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So here it is. All this time, John was wondering, am I ever going to get through this? On a lonely isle of Patmos, is God going to make a way for me and the people that have decided that they were going to stand and say Jesus is Lord instead of Caesar's Lord? Through all the suffering, through all the pain, and now John sees the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb, which means he sees his name. And I can hear John saying, wow, it's been worth it. I don't know what you've had to go through, but if you've been faithful to God, God will one day give you a vision and a reward beyond what you ever could think or imagine. And for someone, you've been through some challenging times. You've been through some tough times. But God will do exceedingly and abundantly beyond what you ever could think or imagine. I'm a witness. 9 months after we finished Howard Divinity School, Reverend Smith, and it was a case by which we went through the most challenging times of our lives. No money. It was a case, no churches. We were actually praying about pastoring in Africa because we just wanted to have a place to do the ministry of God. And in the New England Conference where we were, virtually no one was being asked to pastor from New England. Most cases, it was from Philadelphia or New York. Churches in New England were being filled. And so it looked like there was no hope. And then all of a sudden, out the blue, literally, the bishop called and said, Granger, there's a church in Fort Washington, Maryland. And if you and your wife would be willing to go down to this place, and I know you've never heard of it before, but I believe God's going to bless. And here it is now, some 35 years later. I just want you to know, your fasting is not in vain. Your praying is not in vain. Your believing is. God is going to work it because his destiny for you, his purpose for you cannot fail. If you try to be faithful, even in the midst of adversity, God will make ways out of no way. Talk to me, Moses. I know you were in the wilderness for 40 years, but when you got to the Red Sea, he opened it up. Talk to me, Joshua. I know you were going through the fact of Moses dying and you did not know how things was going to work out. Talk to me, Esther. Here you were in the king's palace and your people were getting ready to die. But if you said, if I perish, let me perish. I'm going to see the king. Talk to me, David. You're in the midst of a giant by the name of Goliath. And it seems like you were one of Saul's boys. But all of a sudden, Saul turned his back on you. And you had to go through a wilderness situation. But one day, the people that God told you you were going to be serving came to you and said, we want you to be king. Talk to me, Jesus. On the cross, it looked like it was all over. But 3 days later, you got a somebody today. Despite what it looks like, you need to know that God's going to give a reward far beyond what you ever could think or imagine. So today, we're in worship. Today, the Bible is sharing that worship that we had seen in chapter number 4 and 5 of Revelation, we're now seeing again. And in that worship, God is showing John the beauty of the city. And in the beauty of the city, he's showing us that it's a perfect cube. Everything is perfectly dimensioned. And some of us may know this fact because one of Dr. King's most famous sermons taken from the book Strength to Love was called The Three Dimensions of a Complete Life. And Reverend Turner, the reason why that sermon was so important because Dr. King addressed it to youth. Many of the sermons that Dr. King did obviously were dealing with racism and classism and militarism. But this sermon was focused to youth. And he was saying that the city was complete in all its dimensions. Its height, its breadth, and its length were all equal. And Dr. King was sharing that the length of life is what you believe you should be doing individually. And he was talking to young people and saying in that, whatever you have to do, do it the best you can. In your studies, do the best you can. And he was saying, I know the challenges that many of you have to face. And some of you are in situations that make it hard to do your best. But Dr. King was saying, don't slack off. Continue to do your best because you're not the first ones to go through challenging situations. And he gave a roll call of African-American leaders during that time. And he was sharing, if they can do it, you can do it. And he was saying, as you do your best, you got to love yourself. You cannot be so down on yourself to think that you don't have what it takes in order to get what God would have you to go. And then finally, Dr. King was saying, in the length of life, be honest about your gifts, talents, and abilities. Whatever you are called to do, whatever you are getting ready to do in life, be very clear, this is something you love to do, but also you have to have gifts and talents to do it. If I stood before you today and said, God has called me, I want to be a singer. And I go, blessed assurance, Jesus is, that's right. Elder Cage just said, oh no. Nobody, there's nobody here now, but nobody would be in the sanctuary. But when Elder Cade sings, his mama said he's been singing around the house since the age of 3. If you're around Elder Cade and he thinks he's by himself, he's just singing. It's in him. It's in him because God put music and that has now become, it's like, remember, God said your gifts will make room for you. Never back up from what God has told you you can do and you love doing and you're doing it well because despite what others folks say, despite how unlikely they think it might be, you hold on to the promise God gave you. And Dr. King said that's the length of life. Then he said the breath of life is where you have to make sure your life is dealing and blessing others. There's no point of loving yourself if you don't love your neighbor. Part of life is not just being a blessing, me, myself, and I, but seeing your gifts and talents ultimately being used to help somebody else. And Dr. King said, after you love yourself and acknowledge what your real gifts and talents and passions are, after you see how you've been put on this earth to bless others besides just yourself, he then says, always be mindful that the length of life, you have to look to God to be the author and the finish of your faith. And Dr. King was sharing, he's had some difficult times. He's had some challenging times. And he was saying in the midst of the civil rights movement, especially when he was in Montgomery, Alabama, he was discouraged. He was down. He was being attacked. His home was being bombed. His children were being threatened. And he said there was a woman by the name of Mrs. Pollard. Some of you might have heard the quote that she said, my feet are tied, but my soul is rested, when she walked for 354 days in the Montgomery bus boycott, Minister Robeson. But there, One day she saw Dr. King, his head down after he finished speaking, and she could see he was a little discouraged. And she said, "Dr. King, what's wrong?" And Dr. King tried to play it off, and Mother Paula said, "You can't fool me. Tell me what's wrong." And she said, "Are the white people bothering you?" And Dr. King said, "No." She said, "Remember this, we're with you." And she said, "Even if we're not with you, God is with you. And God will take care of you." That's a word not just for Dr. King, but whatever you're going through, if you have put your faith in God, despite what others may do, despite how others may abandon you, God is always going to be with you. And God will take care of you. That was Dr. King's analysis of what this city with perfect dimensions meant to our young people. But then in John's instance, he's not only seeing how it's perfectly put together, but he's also seeing that it is a blessing beyond measure. For the gates of the city are made of pure pearls. And he says that the wall of the city, it goes on for 1,400 miles. It would be like a wall from literally Fort Washington to Dallas, Texas. It is so magnificent. It was made up of all of these gems, all of these jewels, and many of them, even though we have names of today, there's really not the same jewels. It's not that John is trying to accurately tell you what sapphire, what diamonds, and what other stones it is. He's trying to let you know the magnificence of it. That it's a golden cube. It's one in which the walls are like the breastplate of the priests, in which they had all of these different gems on it. And he was trying to let persons know the magnificence of it is so great, it's beyond your imagination. What God is preparing for you, if you are prepared to be able to adapt to change, if you are prepared to know that you have something to shout about because God says he's going to take away all your sorrows, if you know God is putting things in place for your blessing, then the blessing is that it's going to be so magnificent, so wonderful, it's literally beyond measure. John is trying to say it's not just that it's a 1,400 miles. John is trying to say it's a perfect, it's beyond perfection. It's greater than what you could ever think or imagine. And John goes on to say that the gates are always open. Even though it's a wall, it's not Trump's wall. Because the purpose that John is trying to say, yes, there is a wall, but the wall is so low. It's not intended to keep people out. The purpose is to let you know you are protected in. And as John goes on a little bit further, this measuring and blessing beyond measure, he goes on to say there is no temple in this heavenly city. And for the Jews, it was impossible to even think of how God can dwell and there is no temple. Some of us in the midst of the pandemic were asking the question, how can we have church when the doors are shut? John is trying to say the presence of the Lord, talk to me, Elder Cage, the presence of the Lord is in this place. It is not the building, despite how wonderful the carpet may look, despite how magnificent the pews are, despite how wonderful the outer sanctuary may be, that is not where God dwells. It is his presence. So you can have a magnificent church, but no presence. Or you can have a smaller church, and the presence of the Lord is there, and that's where Jesus dwells. John is saying, your blessing is beyond measure because where God has prepared for you is a place where you don't need a building. All you need is his Shekinah glory. I know what John is speaking about. Brother Brown, I was getting ready to, this is when we were building the church. And for many persons who may not know, this is the largest and most expensive African-American church that was being built at that time. And so it was a case by which the banks were fighting over each other because none of them wanted to just go in by themselves. So they were trying to figure out which bank would be the lead bank, which bank would be second, which bank would be third. It was a case of talking to lawyers all the time, engineers and construction. So it could get worrisome. It was draining both physically and spiritually. And anytime I get an invitation to preach at a church, I always pray to God whether I should accept it or reject it. And this invitation came from a church I'd never heard of before and pastors I'd never heard of before. So I was almost ready to just dismiss it and put it to the side. But I said, no, let me pray. And God said, you should go. And so I remember it was in Washington, D.C. I was tired. I was weary, got lost. And I'm looking for a church and wound up. It wasn't a church. It was just a house. And not just a house. The church was on the second floor of the house. I said, God, what are you doing? And as I got to the house, you had to figure out how you get to the second floor. Got to the second floor. There may have been, Elder Cage, maybe about 20 chairs in what would be a normal living room. The pastor and his wife could not have been nicer and kinder, but there was one person there. And then by the time the service started, there may have been 8 people. And I said, oh, God, why did you? And then all of a sudden, one of those church mothers started singing, the Lord will make a way somehow. And as she started to sing, I can't even come close to the anointing. And in this 8-person church, in this saintly house, church mother started singing. In that little second floor room, the Holy Ghost took over. And the presence of God was there. And she kept on singing. I kept on feeling better. Kept on feeling better. And by the time she finished, the glory of God was so great, there was no sermon. The power. We just shouted and praised God for the next 45 an hour. And after I left, I don't think I can remember feeling better coming out of church than I did there. Here I was looking at the outside. Here I was looking at the interior. Almost determining that God can only be in big places or special sanctuaries. But I found out it can be a little second floor house on a street that nobody knows. Or it can be in a mass cathedral. But the purpose of God being in a church is that his presence shall be there. And when his presence is there, healing is there. When his presence is there, joy is there. When his presence is there, you shall be blessed beyond measure. So hallelujah. John goes on to say that in this city there is no temple, and the light of the city and the light of the temple comes from God and the Lamb of God himself. In other words, when you're in this place, it is the Shekinah glory. It's not a light that comes from the sun. It's not a light that comes from the moon. It's not a light that comes from the stars. But Jesus is the light of the world. And when you have that light, eyes cannot see, ears cannot hear, and your mind can't comprehend what God's getting ready to do. Look out, Ebenezer. Look out, people of God. God's getting ready to bless you. Greater is still coming. Better is still coming. The best is still coming. If you believe it for yourself, God says, I can still do what I said I can do. Hallelujah. Get ready for God's blessings to be beyond measure. Somebody right now, I just feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit saying, we need to go to a word of prayer, and especially to our young people. I know this change has been challenging. You've been out of school in some instances a year and a half, 2 years, and you're wondering what it's going to be like when you get back, whether you're going to be behind a year, a half a year. What are your new teachers going to be like? What's the school environment with social distancing and masking? But if you have faith, I believe that Reverend Turner and Minister Hayes and Minister Robeson are going to let you know that God is still in control. So I want to go to God in a word of prayer on this morning. Eternal God, our Father, we come today in the name of Jesus saying thank you. That where our young people are getting ready to be blessed beyond measure. We want to say thank you that they will go back into the schoolhouse and the school place with the confidence and a knowledge and a fortitude to know that they can do all things through Christ that strengthened them. We ask a special blessing on Reverend Turner, a special blessing on Jasmine Hayes, and a special blessing on Minister Robeson, and a special blessing on all of those who work with our youth and young adults. We ask a special blessing on Reverend Trish Smith, that even though many of the young adults may not be in school, some are. And we ask right now in the name of Jesus for those who may be in school, we ask that your Holy Spirit shall be with them. We thank you that you continue to bless Minister General and our college CFAM ministry. Continue to bless them, to be a blessing to our college students. And when it's all said and done, we want to say thank you. Not only will the students be blessed, but mothers and fathers, grandmothers and grandfathers, aunts and uncles, guardians, anyone who's taking care of our young people. And then, Lord, bless our teachers. Bless Dr. Golson. We ask right now that you bless every administrator, every teacher, every custodian, every bus driver, every crossing guard, whoever is working with our young people in any way, shape, or form. May they be used by you to be a blessing to them. So, Lord, we want to say thank you. We're believing that this school year shall be unlike any other, and that the blessings of God shall be manifested in such a way that persons will know that the blessings of God shall carry them through and allow them to know that they shall have life and have it more abundantly. In Jesus' name, we want to say thank you.